right, so we discussed the fact that melanocytes are going to produce a specific pigment referred to as melanin. Let's go into a bit more detail as to the functions of melanin and the difference in terms of production of melanin between individuals. So let's review this particular slide that we've looked at. So the melanocyte cell is a fairly distinctive cell. Typically, you have these in the stratum basale, which is the deepest layer of your epidermis. And the most significant thing, other than the fact that you have the synthesis or the production of melanin pigment here, is that you have all these processes or extensions of the cell by which that melanin pigment can move in this region and move to the cells that are going to be closely associated to the melanocyte. So remember that most numerous cell of the epidermis, your keratinocytes. So the melanin pigment will move from melanocytes into the keratinocytes in order to protect the nuclei and subsequently the DNA of your keratinocytes. So how is it produced within the melanocyte? This is going to be synthesized from the amino acid tyrosine, which you can see right here, but it will not actually be able to be synthesized unless you have the specific enzyme here. Now, it's the loss of tyrosinase. Anytime you have A's, you know you're talking about an enzyme. If you are not able to synthesize this particular enzyme, you're not able to have the production of melanin, and that's what the disorder albinism is. You're not able to synthesize that specific enzyme. So what you'll have is you will have no melanin produced. So no melanin. Obviously within the skin, this is typically what's the most obvious, but also in terms of the hair and in terms of iris color. So we have to consider those things as well. It's not just skin color that melanin is affecting. So let's talk about functions. Now we know that, of course, melanin is going to be able to absorb UV radiation. If you are exposed to UV radiation, melanin production will typically increase, okay? So that's what a tan is, or you have the production of more melanin, allowing for darker skin color. Now, as we discussed before, melanocytes have those extensions that are going to allow for the melanin to move into the keratinocyte region to protect the nuclei and the DNA. And also it can play a role in terms of neutralizing free radicals. So being able to get those out of the way, this is something that can lead to cancer if it's not attended to. And melanin can play a role in terms of that. Now, in terms of skin color, and this is the same as of what's going to affect hair color, as well as eye color. So even though oftentimes we think of skin color more, it's going to play a role in terms of those as well. The melanocyte number, so the actual cell number, is not very different among individuals. What really is going to play a role in terms of differences that can be observed in skin color, hair color, and eye color is the differing amounts of the pigment that are produced, the different types of the melanin pigments that are produced, and how much is transferred to keratinocytes. And just these specific differences are what can lead to these differences that we're able to observe. Now, let's think of some clinical considerations in terms of melanin. And obviously, one of the first things that you can think of is going to be sunburn. So, if you have exposure to UV radiation, like I said, the melanin production can increase, but it can only increase so much. If it goes to a point where you're getting past that, then you can have what's considered sunburn. So, typically it's a reddening that can occur in that specific areas where you have too much UV exposure. Now, in some areas, you can have accumulation of melanin. These are referred to as freckles, and sometimes, particularly if these occur later on in life, we hear these referred to as age spots or liver spots. Now, different than freckles, you're going to have moles. Moles are going to be typically benign accumulations of melanocytes. Typically, they're going to be raised. Often they're going to be darker, but not necessarily so. And they can be associated with skin cancer. Obviously, not all moles are going to lead to skin cancer. Individuals that have moles typically need to keep a closer eye on it because their frequency or their incidence is a little bit higher for specific types of skin cancer. So let's talk about the differing types of skin cancer. The most frequent type is referred to as basal cell carcinoma. These are going to start with cells in the stratum basale. They are, as I said, these are the most frequent, but also this is the least serious type of skin cancer. It can lead to malignancy, but oftentimes individuals, if there's removal of that particular portion of the skin or those particular cells, you have a high incidence of survival. Squamous cell carcinoma is typically going to originate in the stratum spinosum. And this is kind of intermediate in terms of frequency, as well as in terms of mortality. And then malignant melanomas are going to originate in melanocytes, as the name would indicate. And malignant means that this particular type of cancer will spread. So it will spread to different areas. And due to the fact that it is malignant, it has a higher incidence of mortality.